In today's video, we are going to talk about what to bring to a track, how to prepare for a track day, and we are joined with Mark Wilkins once again, and he coincidentally won his last race last weekend.
Yes, won at Lime Rock last weekend. It was awesome. We're leading the points.
There you go.
All right, so we're here at Toronto Motorsport Park. We're doing another lapping day, so we need to cover a few basics on what we need to do a track day safely. So first and foremost, make sure that the car is serviced up to snuff, fresh oil, all of that. Very important to maintain your car so you're ready to go.
And so you brought a tire gauge as well.
Absolutely, yes. So we bring a tire pressure gauge, which we set the pressures at home. We always set to manufacturer's recommendation, which is on the door sill.
Yeah, so Continental always recommends that you set the tire pressures according to the manufacturer's specifications, which are on the door sills.
And then on top of that, torque wrench, very important. We're driving our car on the road daily. We want to make sure that the wheels are torqued to a good torque level, typically around 90 foot-pounds, just to make sure that everything's snug and safe so we don't lose anything while we're out on the track.
Can you give me a sample torque?
A sample torque?
Torque check.
So the people on YouTube know what a click sounds like.
So we make sure that's on nice and snug. We give it a double hit there. And we just check all of them, make sure that we're in good shape and we're safe.
And we check it throughout the day, basically.
Yeah, we can check it throughout the day. I mean, typically, if your car's up to date on all its service and maintenance, that should be done. We're at the track here. We're going at high speeds. We need to make sure we're safe. It never hurts to take the few minutes to check your torque.
All right, what's next?
Depending on what we do with tire pressure throughout the day, it's always good to have an air compressor. So I bring an air compressor with me, just plugs into the 12 volt. We have an opportunity to add air to all the tires, nice and easy, small, compact. Not a bad idea to have with you. And it's always a good idea too, if you want, bring some paper towel, check the oil, just make sure the oil level's correct. I mean, it could be something silly, maybe you're down a little bit, especially if you've been doing a lot of road driving. Good idea to just have a double check and be extra safe.
What else do you got?
I brought a helmet. So always good idea for a track day to have a helmet. We're at Toronto Motorsports Park here. It's very open. And depending on what the nature of the day is, it's always recommended to have that with you. And it's always a little bit more safe to have that.
Yeah, and all tracks have different regulations. So this one, I believe, wants it for only open top cars. So you don't really need it for a closed top car like this one.
You don't really need it. And again, it's kind of track specific.
That's
so
exactly it.
For the sake of what we're doing today, we won't run it. Obviously, if you have a roll bar in your car or open top, absolutely want that helmet for the most safety possible.
So check with your track.
3, 2, 1, go.
Check with your track.
Anything else?
That's all I've got.
That's it. That's all you need for a track day. But I would also recommend some water and some sunscreen.
Yes.
And snacks.
Absolutely.
This is the snackscription break.
Beef jerky, chips.
Yeah, that's all good stuff. Okay, so let's talk about the car next. So what did we do to the car and why did we do the things that you did?
Okay, so our Veloster N here this is its 7th track day. We've done a couple things just because we're running it more on the track than maybe most people would. So for example, we put Motul brake fluid in it. It's just can sustain the higher temperature for a little bit longer. We haven't had to do anything once we've changed that. So we've also done camber bolts from the Genesis Coupe. That gives us just a mild tick of negative camber.
And that's a really cheap, almost free upgrade, basically.
It's kind of a no-brainer if you're doing a little bit of track running. You know, you got to be a bit careful. If you're driving the car on the street, which I am with this car all the time on road trips, you want just enough negative camber that it's good for the track, but also really comfortable and not dirty on the street. So this is a great balance.
But you don't need to do the camber bolts.
No, you don't need to do the camber bolts. It's just a nice little tickle of added performance, if you will, that has no adverse effects on regular day-to-day driving, but really helps on the track just get a little bit more out of the tire.
And that's only for the front?
Just on the front.
Okay. And we also... That sounds really good. And we also changed something else. We changed the tires.
Yes.
So we had Continental Extreme Contact Sports in our first video, and we have Continental Extreme Contact Sports in this video. So we're excited to see how they perform once again.
Absolutely. No, and massive thanks to Continental for the tire. We're going to go out and put some hard laps on today. It's a hot day, so it's going to be a little greasy, and we're going to be putting them through their paces. I'm excited.
And the brakes are otherwise stock. Everything else is pretty much stock. You didn't really have to do anything to this.
You don't have to do anything. The Veloster N is really set up for this type of thing, and that's why we're running it so much on the track. It's just such a riot to drive, and if you can do a couple small little upgrades to make the car even more fun, why not? It's well suited to this type of thing, and that's why we're here.
So I've got a couple questions for you.
Okay.
Approximately how much does a track day cost?
It depends on the track, so it's highly variable, but at Toronto Motorsports Park, it's extremely reasonable. I believe evening sessions are 100.
And that's good for a track day?
Really good.
Okay. And then the next question, how far are tracks usually from big cities? Because they can't really be too close because of noise, right?
They are. So this track is about an hour and a bit from Toronto. And I think some of the other tracks are about the same.
And you usually can't start driving until at least 10 a.m. because of noise and stuff, right?
Noise. There's always restrictions depending on the track. And especially with your car, too, it's a good point. If your car's too loud, sometimes the track will shut you down.
Yeah. So if you guys with your straight pipe Mercedeses, got my eyes on you.
Pipe everything, by the way. So I'm excited to get back on the track, but this time we're actually going to talk about some different stuff like track etiquette, track excuses, because those are always fun. So Yuri, let's do it.
Send it.
Okay, so we're at Toronto Motorsports Park. We've just completed our pre-track day briefing. So they talked about the flags, talked about some track etiquette, and basically how to get around here without getting in anyone's way and having a good, safe, and most importantly, fun day.
So the first thing we wanna look for, any traffic.
Yep, so we have the green flags displayed so we know the track's open, so we can head on out. There's no cars coming right now, so we wanna enter safely, tend to, you know, stay to the left side in this case here. We never wanna cross the track in front of any cars on track. That's just good etiquette. And, you know, if there are cars coming, you know, work to get up to speed, you know, and you don't have to, you don't have to impede their way. So just be really mindful about what's going on around you. Just be courteous. That's all we're trying to do. And then once you have some clear track and some space, it's game on. It's time to warm up the tires and get some heat and everything. You know, if the car's been sitting, you know, get some oil temperature up. You know, just make sure everything's ready to go. And that just comes with a couple of, you know, relatively modest laps.
So when you jump on the track, is it bad etiquette to use launch control and then fly down that straight?
Yes. You have launch control, it's great, and you can use it so long as you know that no one else is around. But again, it just comes back to that being courteous to everyone else that's running. So for me, I wouldn't even bother with it. It's a lapping day. It's about sort of lap times and just having fun and just getting out on track. So getting that perfect launch doesn't really do much for you. You know, for what we're trying to accomplish.
It's a little bit of a dick move to launch into the track.
It is.
That's good. That's all we need to know.
Okay, so now that we've finished our warm-up lap, we can start to build a little bit of pace, get going here. And, you know, we're always looking, for example, at Toronto Motorsports Park here, they're always making little improvements. So there's some changes today. There's some new white lines I noticed. There's some green passing cones that weren't there on our first track video. So the first thing we always want to do is just get familiar with our new surroundings. And now that the car is ready to go, you know, we want to continue to just get that visual, know exactly what we're looking for here, and take advantage of that so we can...
And so there's a lot of cones set up. Can you explain all of the different cones that we're looking at? Because there's a lot of them.
So the green cones are marking a passing area. We've got these orange cones that mark the entry, the apex, and the exit of the turn, and then right away to the turn in to the next cone. So you basically want to connect the dots of all these cones. And I shouldn't say all of them because that one's not right. We don't want to connect the dot of that one. But generally speaking, they try to help you place the car correctly and on the correct line so that you can optimize your lap time.
So they're all like a pretty good reference point, but not an exact point that you should use.
That's correct. And in some cases, they're not going to put the cone in the middle of the track because someone will just run over it. So even though the cone should be in the middle of the track because that's where the exit of that corner should be, that's not necessarily correct. So you have to take it a little bit with a grain of salt, and some of that just comes with the knowledge of knowing where you want to place the car.
Okay, I got a question about hitting cones. How much damage does it usually do to your car, and is it all right if you kind of hit one?
Well, I always joke that when I'm teaching anybody that you should hit the cones. And I don't mean it literally, but I want you to get to the cones and connect the dots of those cones. It's important to do that. So if you actually hit one, it's not gonna really damage your car. It might put a little scuff or a little scrape on it, so I don't recommend it, but it's not going to a game changer.
But you should avoid hitting them on open lapping track days.
There's no reason to hit anything on an open lapping day.
And there's also no reason to put four wheels into the grass. Which, yes. I've done before.
Yes, so.
I think it kind of happened.
It does happen. You gotta just pace yourself. And I know my problem, which you mentioned in the first video, is I was always very aggressive with my braking.
That it's kind of the whole come up to speed, not down to speed, if that makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense.
Just working up to it, you know, build up to it. You're not on the track every day. So when you get to the track, like anything you do, it's a process. And so just take the time. You can run lots of laps over a course of a day. You don't have to set the world on fire on lap two. So, you know, incremental improvements every lap, fine tuning it, that's what it's all about.
And then another question. Do you set your sport mode on lap three or do you set it before you hop on?
I always just set it to where I like it. So I go in the Veloster N here to N custom and I basically go full aggressive on everything except the damper. I go to sport, so there's normal sport, sport plus. Sport plus is pretty stiff and with the bumps around here, I think a little more compliance is nice. And I think in the first video I recommended the same, which is slightly softer than full stiff. To maximize mechanical grip.
But you wouldn't advise fiddling with settings once you're on the track. Do it before, right?
No, I think once you're on the track, it's eyes forward. Keep the eyes up, focused entirely on the drive and what you're doing. One corner at a time. But yeah, distractions, you don't want them. Put the phone away, put everything away. Just get in the focus and the zone of driving. That's what we're here to do.
And so you don't really want to worry about lap times at first. You pretty much just want to learn the track and you want to know track etiquette. So what is some track etiquette that people should know?
Yeah, I think the big thing is be aware of your surroundings. You know, just if you're, for someone new to the track, it can be kind of intimidating. And a lot of your mental capacity is on just driving and just trying to figure out what's going on. And as you get more experience, that comes naturally. But it's important that as you're learning, to be cognizant of people that are faster or that are around you so that you're safe first and foremost, but that you can let people by. You don't need to race anybody on a lapping day. You know, you're focused on your own deal. So yeah, it's good to have fun with other cars, but if they're clearly faster than you, just let them go. Let them, don't impede their day. Let them have fun too.
So if you see them coming up in your rearview mirror and you know that they're faster than you or they're catching you in the corners and then you're getting away on the straights or the opposite, what do you want to do? Do you want to put a signal? Do you want to give a pass by? All that kind of stuff.
Yeah, if you're clearly faster and you're in a good passing, good safe passing zone, I always recommend staying on the line. Don't get offline. Don't move out of the way. So the driver behind who's faster doesn't know what you're thinking, doesn't know what you're doing. So the best thing you can do is be consistent, stay on your line, and let them go around you. If it's a signal or a point by, depends on the day. Different lapping days have different rules. For the most part, a signal is totally fair. Signal to the side you want them to pass you on. Keep it nice and simple, easy. You know, it's just about that etiquette and being nice and letting people go and go on about their day. And hey, if you can find more speed or you're clearly quicker, you want them to return that same favor.
And so if you don't use your signals, what is a point by?
A point by, so if your window's down, then you would stick your hand out and point to the side that you want that faster car to pass you on.
Can we do a mock pass by on the next green cones?
We can attempt.
We'll just pretend, like do the motions as if someone was gonna pass you, because no one's ever gonna catch you.
Yeah, no one's ever gonna catch this guy.
Right, so we come around the last corner and we have two green cones, so that's marking our passing spot. So assume there's a car there to pass and there might be coming up here.
Oh, we got a car coming.
Let's have a bit of patience. We'll just keep the speed down here and we'll let him.
We'll get him on the, he'll let us pass.
We'll let him pass and we'll show what we mean here.
He is on his warm-up lap, so we are letting him pass.
He is on his warm-up lap, but he looks like he's ready to go and maybe he's been out for that warm-up lap already. So we'll just hang tight here. See if he's ready, or when he's ready, we'll give him that point by. And
so if you pass, you do all the work, and if you're getting passed, you stay predictable.
Correct.
Exactly.
You nail it. Exactly. That's exactly what you want. So we're online right now. We're going down the back straightaway, and I'm just going to throw my signal on here to the right, and it shows that he now can go and pass me. And see how clear and clean that was? He's clean and clear. We have no one behind, no pressure. We can focus forward, focus on our driving. He can do the same. Everybody's happy and it's a great day.
Now, because you're you, can you catch him?
I always want to, but there's one thing we need to talk about etiquette, and that is that if you are going slower but you can go faster, it's not really nice to then repass the guy right away. So it's a little bit of a cat and mouse game, and then he's going to wonder what the heck I'm doing. So
don't worry, we know him. It's
fine. He doesn't know me.
Yeah.
He might know you.
I'll send him a text message.
Yeah.
In fairness, it's you know, it's all about that consistency and that respect. And you know, I think he was giving us lots of room and we held up and waited for him. So if we go and blow by him, he's gonna wonder what the heck's going on. We've run a few laps here. We know our bearings. We know some of the changes to the track. We're comfortable, we're familiar. So it's time to pit. So when we pit, we put our signal on and stay to the left. that shows anybody that's behind that we're exiting the track. So another good track etiquette rule.
And how many laps roughly would you want to do in a session?
It depends. I mean, some cars require a bit of a cool down. Our Veloster N does not. We could run all day if we want. But typically for the mind, it's good to run a handful of laps, say 6 to 10 or maybe up to 12. Typically, you know, no more than a 15 or 20 minute session, I would say. Come off the track, regroup, have a drink of water, make sure that your mind is sharp, and head back out.
Park the car, lift the e-brake, and then...
we come to a stop here. We've now put the car through its paces. Everything's hot, so we want to go into first gear. Actually, what we'd like to do, depending on the car, is just give it a second for all the coolant that to cycle. Let the car run. The fan will come on and stay on after the car's off, but I like to give it just a little bit of a breather. And then when it's time, we go to first gear, shut the car off, leave the e-brake down. We don't want to pull the e-brake up. It could have an effect on your rotors. You could warp the rotors when they're hot.
How would that happen? It would just stick?
It's just because you're clamping the pad to the rotor. It's sticking. And because the rotor is so hot, you can actually imprint some material, I think, on the disc itself. And when you go back out again, you might find that you have just a slight pulsation. So to avoid all that and let the brakes cool down nice and even, leave it in gear so long as you're on a flat surface and it's safe, and let everything cool down.
And so your first lap out is always your warm up, and your last lap out is always your cool down.
A cool down is always a good idea. It never hurts. You know, just you've been hard on the car, you're hard on the motor. You've got temps are up high and you're working everything. So the recommendation of like one or two cool down laps to let everything come back down is always recommended and can't hurt.
And then okay. Are we going to check our tire pressure and take a visual look at everything, or is it pretty good to go?
Absolutely. It's always good just to have a quick look around the car. We can check pressures again, make sure everything's good, and then we'll be all set to head back out and have more fun.
Should we have this little snack break?
Yeah. Snacks.
All right. So we're done our driving for the day. How did we do compared to how we started last time?
You know, you guys really started today how you left off the last time. I mean, you're driving. Yeah, it was awesome. I mean, we're on it's a hot, humid, sticky day today, and the track's a little greasier, but you guys really retained the knowledge that you gained from our first day, and that says a lot. You know, to take on just one day of coaching and then come back and apply that and not fall back into some of the old habits is awesome. So
hot and sticky, is that bad or good?
Hot and sticky tends to be bad because, you know, motor runs a little warmer, makes a little bit less power. You know, the tires, the grip level changes, the track changes. It's a little bit greasier, meaning that the car slides around more. So to find, you know, outright pace is a little more tricky.
So those are a lot of excuses coming from a racing driver that we've also been making.
So what racing excuses can we use if we're ever slower than we once were?
So you go to a track, your first track day, you're not having the best day, you're recording your times. What do you say to your friends after you come back in?
Oh, I think the list is endless, you know. Oh, you know, the sun was fully out, and the track temperature went up a little bit. You know, maybe I just didn't have enough water, so I'm a little dehydrated. Maybe I missed the mark.
What about, like, not going to the bathroom? Like, I was holding it in, I couldn't go, had that extra weight on me.
My concentration is elsewhere. I don't know, I had to go pee, and, you know, I just should have thought about it before, but I'm just a little off my game, so as a result, you know, lap times suffer.
And you've even been to this track before, but let's just say you didn't have a great lap time this time, but now it's hotter this time, right? So the engine is suffering, everything else is suffering, you're tired because it's also hotter, right?
Yeah, absolutely. There's all these factors. I mean, we always say with as far as performance at a race is you can't really take lap times from a previous day and bench off of those because the ambient might be very different. They might be cloudy.
The ambient
temperature.
That's a good one.
The track temp might be much higher or could be lower. It's never quite the same. So you really can only take information from one specific day and run with that and see how you compare to... you know, to everybody else that's running that day.
And then what are some other cool race car lingo on track stuff that we can use? Because last time you dropped catching cars out of my snack bracket.
And let's explain that.
I absolutely, you don't need to explain it.
Well, the Veloster N tends to run pretty strong everywhere we take it here against some cars that might be a little heavier, but definitely have a lot more power. And so maybe they're out of the snack bracket. I mean, I don't know, if we talk about price especially. So we're competing against some pretty good hardware here. And, you know, I got a new one for you today.
Okay.
Stove it in.
What does that mean?
I think if you stove it in, it means you send it. You're going for the inside, and you hope that the guy you're passing knows you're there.
Oh, so that's strictly like a racing move, where you just stove it in, that you're just gonna kind of take him on the inside.
Can we stove it into cliche corner?
I don't recommend stoving anything on the street. Just, you know, on the track, at least there's maybe some, you know, there's some margin for error.
But margin for stovage?
Margin for stovage. I like that. Maybe that's a new one. There was enough margin for stovage, so I stoved her.
But never pass people on the inside of a corner outside of a passing zone on the track.
Correct.
So what other good excuses?
Dive bomb. Okay, so the precursor to the stove it in, I think, would be the dive bomb.
Okay.
Where you're just dive bombing a guy and you hope it sticks. You know, on a lapping day, we don't want to do that. You know, we're out having fun today, but when we're talking racing terminology here, you know, when we come off the track and, you know, the blood pressure's up and the heart rate's up and, you know, you're full of adrenaline, you come up with some pretty interesting terms to describe things. I think one time I said, it handles like it's on bananas. So I don't know if that was a Mario Kart reference or right. What, but everyone looked at me like, well, what does that mean? I'm like, I don't really know. I just didn't have any grip, so I thought of bananas.
That's your new quote.
That's my new quote. That's my my other line. So I don't know, you come up with some weird stuff in the heat of the moment.
And so dive bombing and stuff like that, you shouldn't do, because that leads to late braking and then some people end up off the track.
You have to have confidence that the person you're passing is going to know you're there, so that if you stove it in or you dive bomb or you do any of these type of things late in the corner and they don't see you, well, your day's ending on a pretty expensive note. So we for lapping days and fun, we want to keep it safe and get the passing done on the straights.
So to wrap up the day and the wrap up the video, is there anything that you want people to take away from when they get to their first track day and they have a lot of fun?
Yeah, on your first track day, take your time. It's going to be overwhelming. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, learn at your own pace. Be smart, you know, be mindful of the cars that are around you and you know, give them room and get out of their way and, you know, just let them enjoy their day. But for you, if you just are smart about your passes, you're aware of your surroundings and, you know, you're just kind of logical on how you go about it, you'll be just fine.
And come ready with a bag of snacks and a bag full of excuses.
Yeah.
A bag full of excuses is always good.
That's the most important,
but
I would
say. But the end of the day, as long as you're having fun, that's the point. And, you know, that's why we come and do this. And it just gets in your blood and you want to do more and more of it.
And if you're driving your car that's currently a road car, you want to drive it home at the end of the day. So don't go too crazy.
Don't go too crazy. Have fun. A track like Toronto Motorsports Park here is very open. So, you know, we have the opportunity to drive in a safe environment here, learn at our own pace. And the track's really great about allowing people and newcomers especially to come and enjoy it, experience it, and, you know, and learn and just have a good time. That's what it's all about.
Well, even Buddy in the yellow Mustang, that was his first time on the track.
That's right.
And he got the yellow Mustang because of our video.
Yeah. So Mahmood is a subscriber of ours, and we met him today.
Shout out.
Great guy.
We pass them all the time.
Exactly. So he's going to watch this video after and learn even more, but he had a lot of fun today.
That's awesome.
Can you catch this guy?
Yeah, let's see if we can
catch
this guy.
We know him, so it's all right.
Okay, so
you guys are adding a lot of extra weight to this deal.
Yeah, we are.
I can jump out.
I can jump out.
Yo, is he out of your snack bracket?
That's a little out of the snack bracket, but we're holding our own, okay?
Oh, yeah.
If you were solo.
Oh, for sure.
If we were solo, yeah, you guys are hurting my hurting the vibe here, but we'll just stove it in maybe.
On the way out, Mark, give some shout outs for your stuff again.
Well, shout out to Brian Herta Autosport. Shout out to Mason Philippi, my teammate Michael Lewis, and Harry Godsacker. These guys are rocking it, some young talent. And yeah, we're leading the points. We're leading the championship right now in the Velostrand TCR. So we've got four races left to go. Cheer us on, follow us. And yeah, we're going to have some exciting racing coming up.
And check out Mark's video on Motor Trend.
Yeah, exactly. Shout out to all Mark's sponsors. Thank you guys all for watching. Shout out to Continental for sponsoring this series. Thank you guys so much.
Don't forget to subscribe. Hit the notification bell.
Check out patreon.com/thestraightpipes. Don't forget to subscribe once again and hit the notification bell.